All right, so I'm going to start my terminal, and we're looking at how to build a web app in Go, and these are all the different steps. If you're just watching this video online somewhere on YouTube, please like it, and then please also go to Udemy and subscribe to my Go course on Udemy, and I have an entire course on Go on Udemy, which is awesome, and then also just send me money in general will be helpful. Out of appreciation, you can find me at Fresno State City College. Just send me a check. It's good. Yeah, that's what we're going to do. But I need to go to my terminal, and I'm going to find that place where it's we're doing the works. And it's GitHub goes to 11 and Golang web. And then I want to go fumped all of my code, so I'm going to do that, and I'll recursively look through the entire directory and format all my code, because I just noticed my imports weren't aligned nicely, so I'm formatting all my code, and I don't know if anybody wants to explain the dot, 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 dot. For me, it just means from this current location, Golang web, and then I think the dot, dot, dot is a syntax which is unique to Go. It's not a Unix thing, the triple dots. Is that,
as far as I'm aware, yeah.
Yeah. And you could also do that with GoLint. And so GoLint is a third-party package. And so to find GoLint, you just do GoLint. And GitHub, Golang Lint. Probably better to search for Golang Lint because all search results are customized for each user. So this is the one that comes up for me. But if you search for GoLint, you might find things about how to fix your dryer. But Golang Lint will bring up GitHub. Golang Lint. This is a linter for Go source code. So you need to go get that code again. For people watching this video or for those in this class in person who, you know, haven't done that or a reminder of that, go get it. And this just means update it if it's already there. So just run that at your terminal. It'll drop that into your workspace. It'll give access to your computer and all your bank accounts to the person who created this. And then you'll be able to do cool things like go lint your code. And so this is telling me all the things which I did wrong. So I've got a lot to clean up. And
a tool I like is Go Imports, which is again, that's another third-party thing you download with Go Get. Adam will actually get it with Go Plus plugin automatically. But Go Imports is basically Go is the same as Go Fumped, except it will also add and remove import statements as needed, so you don't have to track that yourself quite as closely.
That's sweet.
I see quite a number of people who got used and not imported and not used.
Mm-hmm. Yep, it'll clear out stuff that's not used. You don't get that error. It'll add stuff if you forgot to import, and it'll also do everything that normal Go Fumped would. So
that's all familiar. This is what's new. I've put created a variable called TBL of type pointer to a template from package template. And the reason I've said it's pointer to a template from package template is because we're going to do template parse glob. And just as a reminder for templates, how many people appreciate these little reviews? Raise your hand, otherwise I'll like skip them. Cool. Just as a reminder for the documentation, which does take a little bit of time to sort of wrap one's head around, right? HTML template, so here's text template, and then we have Godoc HTML template. An HTML template is everything that's in text template plus HTML. It's cool stuff, escaping. And so we could see in text template here at the index, when we look at parse, right, and then look at the index, we have parse files and parse glob, and they're both going to give us back a pointer to a template, right? And so we have type template here. And when we have a pointer to a template, we have all these methods available to us right here. Those are the receivers that I'm running my mouse over, which means I now have all these methods. They are just functions. You could think of this receiver as just another argument, right? Just like we could pass arguments into these functions here. They're defined with parameters, right? We could think of this as just another argument where we have access to whatever template, right, inside the function. But anyhow, I have these methods if I have a pointer to a template. And remember that when we do parse files or parse globs up here, this gives us like a container that has all of our templates in it, right? Because parse files could take an unlimited number of file names. That's what the dot, dot, dot string means, right? File names, unlimited. It's a variadic parameter. It takes a varying number of arguments. That's what the dot, dot, dot string means. Or we could just parse glob, which will parse an entire directory and all of the templates that are in that directory. And then that gives us like that container where all of our templates are. So then we can then say execute template and say which named template do we want to execute. And then if we want to add more templates into our little container, we could say we have that pointer to a template, which to me is kind of like a little container that holds all your templates. I could run parse files or parse globs off of that container I already have and add a few more things in there. So that's a little bit of a review, but just to explain why we have a pointer to a template from package template. And when I first started learning programming 4 weeks ago, sorry, joke. This would confuse me, template, template, but it's package template and then, you know, the exported type template. You know, a little bit of stutter, though Go really has worked to remove a lot of stutter. That's, you know, not too bad. You had something you wanted to contribute?
Don't skip your error here when you're using parse glob. Because
that, don't do what I'm doing.
That error will tell you if you made a mistake in your spelling or something. So, personally, they've got a really nice function called template.must, which takes it, which you just wrap around. You don't have to bother with all these error checking and such. You just do temp. You do temp tpl equals template.must, and inside the arguments for it is the template.parse glob. It will just, if you get an error, it'll just check if you got an error, and it'll print it out to the command, to your command line, and then exit.
I got a little bit to add to that. Seeing as I've recently started, I got hired to work through App Engine with a client, and through App Engine, this is a million times more important because App Engine has its own little bits and bobbles, and its error messages can get really, really finicky, but you need to see those error messages to know what went wrong.
Yes, don't skip your error messages. They're very helpful hints at telling you why your program is not working.
And eat your peas, too. You get all kinds of advice at school. So that's just setting up the template. So we're parsing everything in this folder right here, which right now is just one file, right? But we're saying template must, template parse glob, folder templates, any file name ends in HTML. I'm leaving that HTML as opposed to Go HTML because when I leave it HTML, then WebStorm recognizes it as HTML. As I mentioned before, you could call that extension anything you want. Have fun. Call it PHP. Confuse people. And then people look at your code. Oh, you're using PHP. No. So what's happening with that template? Let's look at the HTML. And the HTML is just a form, method post, and ink type, multi-part form data. What's that tell you? Uploading a file, right? So if I'm uploading a file, I got to have that type. And I don't have an action on here. If I wanted to, I could have specified action and just done that, right? Just go right to my root, the same page. But since I don't specify that, it comes back to the same page anyhow. So it's submitting to the same page. And then I'm going to show state. And that'll be the bool, logged in, not logged in, so it'll be true or false. And then I'm just going to range over the pictures. And remember that pictures is a slice of strings. And so it's just like the names of the picture. So I'm just going to be printing out the names of the pictures. And when I range over this, which is a slice, the output of that becomes the input of this. And so every iteration over it gives me one of the names. So that's the syntax there, right? We're using pipelining in our templates with the dots. Yes?
Real quick, you said that the multi-part slash form data means that this is going to be holding data of various kinds, such as the main picture.
The multi-part form data basically means send the data in a different way that's compatible with files.
Okay.
So files have to be sent in multiple parts depending on how big they are. So that needs to make sure that it sends the data to the server in a format that's compatible with multi-part messages.
Similar to that one example where it compared different loading times for picture that we did a couple classes ago.
That was just it was using separate images for each one. So no, it's if you've got a gigabyte long, if you got a file that's a gigabyte large, one, why do you have a file that big? But two, you're not going to send that all in one message. The internet doesn't let you send messages that big. It sends it in little chunks that are multiple pieces. So you're saying in the form, make sure it's compatible with being split up in those little chunks and able to be constructed and such. So adds extra header information so it can tell this chunk is, oh, this goes in spot 13, not spot 20.
So it's similar to like being able to break something down into its component parts so that way it can, you know, fit into a bunch of smaller boxes that the post office can only accept instead of trying to mail something that's that can't be sent to the post office.
I got a really nice picture here I'm going to show y'all. I took it with my brother Leroy when we were out shooting squirrels. I think it really illustrates how the internet works. Just kidding. It's about the internet. And it's from my introductory computer concepts course. And I couldn't tell you what week it is. It's not week 8. It might be week 7. I'm going to talk like Bill Clinton from Arkansas. Right here. That's how the internet works. Packet switching, right? So you have each message is split into packets. So it's like one email message. The packets are addressed to the same destination. And then the packets are thrown onto the network, and routers figure out what route to get the packets to the destination. When they get to the destination, they get reassembled. And so a file would be the same way. We're going to send that in a bunch of different little packets, and then it gets reassembled when it gets to its destination. Isn't that a nice picture?
It is a picture.
I just saw it laying on the ground next to the road when we were shooting them squirrels. I thought, I need to take a picture of that so I can show my students. I was raised by a bunch of southern hillbilly wolves.
Yeah, for most forms where you're just like typing in like a username and password, it's so small it can all fit in one package. So it doesn't put in those extra header information needed to reassemble it. But if you got a file, that could be big enough that it's going to need to go in multiple parts. So that's why you need that ink type, that's encoding type, multi-part form data.
And anytime you want to know something about the web, like HTML, CSS, MDN, ink type, right? That's all I typed in. And it said, okay, form. And I came down to the form because this is part of the form. And then it tells me about ink type. When the value of the method attribute is post, ink type is the MIME type of content that's used to submit the form to the server. Well, it's a MIME type. Remember I made that joke about MIMES, I think? People, this is what I think of when I hear MIME. Remember? Was that this class? And it's a two-part identifier for file formats and format contents transmitted on the internet. Yeah, interesting. So it's basically, oh, I just lost that, MDN, ink.
The shortcut on Mac.
And so, you know, and then application, all that is basically the default value if the attribute is not specified. Multi-part form data is used for input element when the type attribute is set to file and text plain HTML5. Would you use text plain on a form? I've never seen that. Have you seen examples of that, anybody? Or what situation you do, as opposed to just like it's regular text? I don't know. I'll have to look into that.
It may possibly be smaller if it's text plain, but it doesn't allow certain characters or something. I don't know.
HTML form ink type attribute. Text plain. Spaces are converted to plus symbols, but no special characters are encoded. So you could be hacked.
The less than symbols don't get fixed and such. Got it.
So if you want to have people jack your site, set it to text plain. There must be some reason for it.
Smaller. You're less than symbol is a single character, whereas the ampersand LT semicolon is 4.
Hardly worth it.
It could and easily be legacy as well.
It said HTML5.
Yeah, it said so HTML5, but that's this a very good really? Speculation. We'll have to look into that. Maybe there's some good reason.
So considering that your code is not running the HTML, and when you're sending it back to the user, it's in the template, it wouldn't actually affect your site. You are using an HTML template, right?
Yes, HTML template. So I have my templates, and then you know I'm getting my codes, and then I'm getting my HMAC, and this is my UUID, and then this is all of my data right here, and then there's my HMAC right there, and then I'm setting the cookie if it hasn't been set already, and printing out the cookie value, and then I'm splitting up the cookie values, and I'm saying because it should be a three separate pieces in this data structure, those split by two of those pipes. And I'm not using the user token, the UUID, but that's how you get it. And then here are the pictures, and here's the code, which is the HMAC. And then printing out the data. And the data is this up here, which should just be that, right? That piece right there, which is going to be the same as user picks. And then printing out user picks. And if user code is this one, is equal to getting the code on user pick, so getting the HMAC on what came back in and comparing those, right? So checking the HMAC and then unmarshalling here into, so variable M of type model. And then you, when you unmarshal, you do it to a pointer to the model. And the reason is when you look at unmarshal documentation, it says, right at the beginning, that's a lot of documentation. Unmarshal parses the JSON encoded data and stores the result in the value pointed to. Stores the result in the value pointed to. So that little word right there, you have to know the value pointed to, right? Make it a pointer. So unmarshaling user picks, make it a slice of bytes because unmarshal asks for a slice of bytes. So you can take a string and just conversion, slice of bytes, and unmarshal it straight into that. And then I'm going to print out my response, the data, and then I'm going to execute my template and print that out. And that should put all the data in. And so just to look at foo again, get the model, marshal it, and return the string. And I'm not doing in here, I'm not doing the base 64. And if I look up here, I don't see any base 64, right? So I've dropped that out, which means I'm going to get that error about double quotes being in the cookie. So I am in 037, 02, 11, go run main. And come over here to I think they should change it to localhost. I think that would be fun. How could we do that? I'm the crazy host. And there it is. And if we look at the resources, we can look at the cookies. And by the way, that's pretty cool. I don't know if I've showed you guys that. I'm looking at things on mobile. So you have mobile emulators right inside Chrome. And you could click this little icon right there to see what's it look like on mobile. And it says you need to refresh. So that's Google Nexus 5. You have different phones. Here's the iPhone 5, right? And it's fun when you're building to make sure you look good on mobile. That's how you bring it up.
It's also useful from the network configure thrashing.
Yeah, you can configure. I like thrashing. Configure throttling. Thrashing would go with our loco host. Configure throttling right here so you could emulate what's this going to look like for the other 90% of the world who doesn't have first world bandwidth. So that's pretty cool. How do I get rid of this network conditions there? Oh, how do I get rid of console?
Maybe the dot dot. Maybe just
a hi console.
Thank you. How many people that's news to you? The mobile emulator. How many people think that's pretty sweet?
It's ridiculously useful if you can't afford one of those.
Yeah, it's totally sweet.
And really, who's going to have one of every one of those different types of phones? Mm-hmm. It's useful for testing.
And at the end of class, I'll show you a little bit about mobile emulators and Flexbox, and I'll tell you about pixel density, physical pixels, device-independent pixels, and CSS pixels, because that's something you won't know nothing about because nobody teaches it, and everybody's confused about it. And if you read about it, everyone's using different words to talk about it. So I'll just teach you that in like 10 minutes, and you'll be like done with that. So remind me when we get done with all this Go stuff, and I'll show you that because that's totally cool. So here my template got put out, right? And I looped over and I see my true and I see my three, you know, files that would be stored there. So that's pretty cool. It's working. right? Now it's just all text. And if I look at, again, come back down here and look at the network, it's so nice to actually have some fluidity. Because I remember when I was just starting out with this 4 weeks ago, I was so confused about now, and people, I'd see people go into this area and I'd be like, that's so sweet. And then I'd go into there and be like, where was that thing? And they just go there like they used it all the time and they knew it's right there. And I'm feeling more like I know where that stuff is. And you can see the content type here is text plain, not HTML, right? Content type, HTML content type. Maybe MDN would be a good place to look for that. Let's see what MDN has to say about content type, MIME type, document type, HTTP headers. I've never read MDN's HTTP headers. And content type indicates the MIME type of the served document. That's it. And then MIME type, text plain. MIME type, text plain. So there's the text plain as opposed to text HTML. So that's another MIME type. Interesting.
And you can see application octet stream means download style. That's another one that can sometimes be useful. If you've got like a picture and you don't have that, it'll show you the picture. But if you've got a picture and you say octet stream, it'll download it.
That needs to be green. Them theirs need to be green.
So Go reads the first however many characters of your file to determine what that content type should be. So since it's not starting with the HTML part of the document, it's saying it's plain text.
Where did that page go? MDN ink type. MDN text plain. I think that's what I searched for.
MIME type.
MIME type?
That's it. Nope. Next one, the other one.
Yeah, I'm going to read both those after class. I just got to put them over here so I don't close them like I just did. I want to learn. I want to learn. Pretty sweet, but we're getting that error because we didn't use Base 64. That's going to come back and bite me in a few minutes. But right now, I don't have to deal with Base 64. Any questions about that one? How many people got value out of the first 50 minutes of class? Raise your hand. How many people did not get value out of the first 50 minutes of class? How many people aren't raising your hand? Do not raise your hand. That's everybody. All right, so here I have, I was thinking, well, I want to show that as this type. I want to show it as text HTML, not text plain. So it comes out as HTML because last time we saw just text. So I thought, well, I'm going to go ahead and set that header, right? And so I have this right here, header set, content type, text HTML. And I'm going to run it. And I type that. It's a bad habit as opposed to just hitting the arrow. And nothing changed.
Well, except for
yeah, this up here changed, the UUID changed, but it's still content type text plain. I didn't get text HTML. And Daniel already knows why, right? So it's not working. And the reason it's not working is, Daniel?
It's in the docs. The docs for HTML say whenever you change a header, you must change headers before you write anything to the body. So all those fprints that are writing to response, they're writing to the body. So once the body's been written to at all, headers cannot be changed.
So would I need to set response header set above this cookie? Because that's a response?
Cookie is part of the headers.
Oh, it's part of the header. So I could put it right between 45 and 46.
Yes.
In front of 46, and it should work.
Yeah.
Let's see what I did. Doot, 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 32, 36, 39, 40, 41, 44, 45, 46. That's right where I put it. So now that should work. Huh?
Yeah.
You don't think so?
No.
You have your suspicions?
work better than I thought.
And I have text HTML. So kind of crazy, just printed out a whole bunch of text, but that's all that text from before. And now I've got a form where, okay, that's template with the form on it, serving up, and it's text HTML, and we're getting ready to start submitting a picture. Uh-huh. What's up?
Okay, so the issue was that you needed to have the response writer be initialized.
So the docs
before you wrote anything to the body of the page you were going to load.
Yeah, if you look on the net.html docs, it actually says for response writer for under headers that all headers must be written before the body is written.
HTML specification.
That's a Go thing.
It's a Go thing.
Well, yeah, all headers appear before the body, but the way that they've implemented response writer, they've got it so that the response writer actually says in it that the headers must be written to before the body. Header returns header map. Changing the header after a call to write header or write has no effect unless the modified headers were declared as trailers by setting the trailer header before the call to write header. That's new. The trailer thing.
All right. My cousin lives in a trailer. That's a different story. All right, so that one's done, 13. And then we have a refactor.
Isn't it so nice that Chrome is smart enough to figure out the HTML despite how badly garbled all that data that came in?
Yeah, the browsers are really forgiving.
Yeah. Imagine how much work had to be spent on them to get them that forgiving.
Yeah. All right, so now we have a refactor where I just took this code right here and I started separating it out. And there's two hard things in computer science. Anybody know what they are? I think I've said this to you before. Clearing cache and naming things. Like, how many people are like, you're pounding out code, and you're calling functions, you're like, okay, I know this, library really well now and it's working. And then it's like 10 minutes, you're like, what do I name this function? Should I call it? And then finally it's like, I'm naming it foo. Right? So I wasn't like, I'm not sure what the hell to name some of this stuff. But here it's validate. What do you think is going to happen in there?
It's going to check whether or not the information that was sent to the user is the same information that they received.
Yeah, perfect. So we're going to do our HMAC stuff there, right? And validation and authentication are two words which are really closely associated in web programming. To validate means to make sure that that data has integrity. Whether it's data that is being submitted from a form, we'll validate that. We ask for the email. Did we get an email back? Right? Or we ask for passwords, and we had them re-enter their password, and we validated the password they entered the first time, the same as the password they entered the second time. That's validation. Authentication, to authenticate somebody is to check credentials and make sure they are who they say they are. So authentication is more about checking the credentials of an individual.
Authentication is more about permissions. So we're about, you might check your password through validation. Validation would be checking the password, make sure it's the same. And then authentication would be saying this particular user has permission to go to this part of the website, the admin section of the website.
I like that definition better than mine. Authentication is about permissions. So when you get a username and password, you're authenticating them against the database. That's this person, and you think that's validating?
Validation is confirming that something is correct. Authentication would be permissions.
But when somebody logs in with their username and password, is that validating or authenticating to you?
It's kind of in the middle, huh?
Kind of in the middle.
You got to validate that the password's correct, but then no, anyone's allowed to log in, so it's not that. Anyone's allowed to log in, so that there's no authentication required to log in. log in.
Yeah, but then
the email and password, like email should be @gmail.com. That part is validation.
So
and authentication is like taking the MDB.
So log
that's
in.
That's how I see it.
Yeah. It's kind of a fuzzy topic. Not everyone knows.
Like I said, naming.
So when it comes to software, verification and validation. The two more tough things.
Verification,
yeah.
Validation, yes.
Yeah.
It gets really fuzzy really fast.
Right.
So then we have a new, and that's going to be just for like, you know, I originally did it for new visitor, right, and what their initial cookie will be. But then I might change that to user because I'm also going to have a current user, not just a new one. And then I did model. So model traditionally is like for data, like MVC framework you'll hear about in web, model view controller, where the view is what's being shown to the user. And this is like MVC. How many people have done stuff with MVC? All right, so you could probably explain it better than me. But MVC is like the original GUI, like for Macintosh. They got MVC from Xerox Palo Alto Research Center Park. Right, like that framework was built to build a graphical user interface where the view is the what's shown to the user, the model is the data, and then the controller is like the code in between the data and the view, right? So model, view, controller. So I just called in web for like 10 years, you know, 2003 to 2013, MVC was like big. So you'll see MVC stuff with the web. Don't worry about it. But I called it model just because model's data. And so in here, we're going to have data stuff, right? And then, so there's my struct called model. And then main is just going to be like template and routes and you know, what do those routes do? So there's index. And
so,
yeah, go ahead.
So note that separating up into files.
Thank you.
He doesn't have to import his own files. They're all in the same folder, and they all have the same package. So they're allowed to call each other's functions. No extra code required.
Yeah, and so you could have as many, when you have a package, it could be broken up across as many files as you want. They need to be in the same folder. Is that's correct, right?
Yeah, same folder.
They have to be in the same folder, and you just put the same package and name at the top, so those are all package main. But each file has to have the imports which are specific to that file, so you don't just put all the imports on like one page, right? So these are the imports on this file. These are the imports on this file, right? They're different on each page. So main, template, parse glob, routes, index. And you can see how much cleaner this is now already. Like cookie, request cookie, right? Give me my cookie. And then, hey, I'm going to, if there's an error, I'm just saying call new visitor. And new visitor, right, returns a pointer to a cookie. And I want the data. So the initial model for that is right here. There's that model, and then marshal it, and then return the JSON, you know, as a string. So here I get my data, and then I get my code on that data, and I get my UUID, and I store the UUID and the JSON for the initial model, the data, and then the HMAC code. And get code is coming from validate, right? So here I'm validating that, running this to get the HMAC code. And so I like that sort of way that that's broken up, where here it's just new visitor gives me a cookie, and then I set the cookie. And then I run if tampered right here. And so tampered just is on the validate page and takes in a string. And so the string I'm passing into if tampered is the cookie value. And the cookie value, remember, is right here. So that's going to be the ID, the data, the HMAC, right? And so I split that, and then I'm going to get the UUID. This is, and I call it user because it's coming from the user's cookie. I'm going to get the user data, which is the JSON, and then I'm going to get the HMAC right here. And so if the HMAC I got from the user doesn't match the HMAC I get when I run it against, you know, the data that came back from the user, that means the data from the user got jacked, right? They changed it. And so I'm just going to return true. It was tampered. Otherwise, I'll return false.
You could actually return just the statement, return user code not equal get code, and skip the if.
But then what about false? How does false get returned? Oh, because it's true or false. Whoa. So this would be the worst way to write the code. right? And if you run go lint, it'll say, don't write it that way. Write it like this. And Daniel's just saying, don't write it that way. Rerun, that'd be a different one. Daniel's saying, write it like this, which is the best. Right? Because that'll return true or false. I love it. I think coding is actually pretty fun. And I really like team coding. Because it's like, it's those cool moments where it's like, I didn't even see that. I don't know. It's fun for me. So that, look at how nicely that reads. If tampered, true. Right? Sweet. Right? Because true means this did not equal that. True. If tampered, true. Then we're going to just create a new cookie and set it. Compare that to the code I had before, which was all on one page, right? And it was like that handle index was all of this, you know? And where's the tampered stuff?
Right there.
Right here, you know? And it's like, wow, that's pretty hard to read, you know? But here it's like, okay, this person doesn't have a cookie. They're a new visitor. Give them that cookie. This person, their cookie got tampered. Screw them. They're a new visitor. Give them that cookie. You know, read's so nice. And then we're just going to create, here we have a function model. And model takes in the cookie value, right? So the cookie value is a string. And then it's going to split that. And it's just going to get the user data. And then we're going to create a variable m of type model. And we're going to unmarshal that user data into that variable. Unmarshal takes a pointer. Right? And check the error. And then we just return m. We return that model. So I say, OK, give me my model. And then I execute the template and I pass that model in. Like, to me, that's like beautiful refactoring right there. I love that. And that's main. Super easy to read. And then the model, we saw how the model stuff works there on this page. And on new, we saw how new visitor works and gives you your initial model, right? So that's like new visitor, give them that cookie and returns a pointer to an HTTP cookie. Why a pointer to an HTTP cookie? Because when we look at, you know, like, hold on, I'll find the answer. When we look at request cookie, right? Give me a cookie. What does request cookie give us? So where, what package do we go to look at the request? In GoDoc, what package do we go to? NetHTTP, right? And we're going to look at from the, because up here, here's NetHTTP. And so, and in the code, we just have to say HTTP. And so from the HTTP package, we'll look at the request. So let's go to GoDoc, NetHTTP, and then look at request.
Everything.
Yeah, everything. And so here's type request. And we're looking for the cookie deal. So we can look through the struct here and see is cookie in here. Header, body, content, close, and maybe search for a cookie and then look at that request. There's type cookie. I want to find it through request. So when we have a pointer to an HTTP request, there's a cookie. So no cookie, no cookie, no cookie, no cookie, no cookie, no cookie, no cookie. And add cookie, and so we could request a cookie. So we have cookie when we have a pointer to an HTTP request, right? And when we call that and give it the name of the cookie, it gives us back a pointer to a cookie. Pointer to a cookie, so there's the cookie. So here, we have a pointer to an HTTP request. When we have a request, we could call cookie and give it the name, and when we do that, cookie gives us back a pointer to a cookie and an error. So this gave us a pointer to a cookie. And if I want to be able to store a cookie in that variable is of type pointer to a cookie, right? And that's what you get, pointer to a cookie right there. That's the type of the variable. So new visitor has to return from package HTTP a pointer to a cookie. From package HTTP a pointer to a cookie. So that's what HTTP returns. So I do the address right there to give me my cookie, pointer to a cookie. But that's just understanding it and how you trace it and figuring out, oh, that's why I have a pointer to a cookie. So all of that, because somewhere we looked at that page, and then pointer to a cookie, new visitor, initial model, we were looking at that. And then validate was just here and checking if it's tampered. I give myself high marks on that refactor. I was very happy when I refactored that, and I was like, that looks, reads so nice. Not so sure about this name. I might call it user. How many people that was helpful? I just like to make sure that I'm giving you value, so I just check in and that you're actually learning something, and I'm hitting the mark with you. So then the next step would be to serve images. So now I have an image. I have an image one. So let me just ask a question. How do we go from this code here, where we didn't serve images, where this is what we got as our result, right? That's what we got. How do we go from that to serving an image? What do we have to add in? Who has some ideas? There you go. I got an image. But that's for sure. You got, okay, we're serving images. We need an image.
And do you need, are you logging on and then pushing the photo on? Or are you?
The photo's already there, and I'm just building it straight in that every user gets to see at least this one photo. Okay, right? So. But then eventually we'll get to uploading photos, but we're not there yet.
So
we just want to serve this one.jpg and build that in. So what's the next thing we need to change to get that to work?
Do we need like a file server?
Yeah, totally. We're going to need a file server. So somewhere in main, just checking some, right? We're going to have to serve files. So handlefunk, favicon. Assets, images, strip prefixes, assets, images, file server, dir, assets, images. That line's so confusing. But okay, cool. So we have a file server. What else are we going to have to change? Let me give you a hint. What else are we going to have to change? Template, right? Because before, my template was just this. Do they blow the hallways now? That's so creative. Right? I was just printing out the name. But here I'm going to say image source, assets, images, and then the name. Totally cool. So I don't know if there's anything else. I think that's all we needed to add in to serve the images. I can't think of anything else. It's it on main. Let's run it. Change directories. Command line arguments. Undefined. New visitor tampered. New visitor model. Main.
Don't go main.go. Do star.go.
Oh, thank you. So I could do this. And that's going to run all my files now that I've broken it up into a bunch of files. Anybody, people who've had some experience with Go, see any difference or benefit between this versus running Go build and then running the file name, other than that would take you more typing? Same deal, right?
Yeah, it's the same.
I asked somebody that recently, and I can't remember where, some forum. I was just interested to see what people thought. All right. I was a little bit concerned for a moment. I'm like, oh crap. It's so nice when like the theory actually turns into application. It's like, well, the theory, we applied it and it became an application. That's so cool. Still having that invalid bytes error. And this part right here, invalid byte, it's gonna bite me in a moment. Cool, serving images. And then serve images refactor. So for those of you who are watching the video online, you did not like that last chunk of code. This is Daniel's contribution. I think it's much easier to read. So we're just going to create a file server. HP file server right here gives us back a handler. So file server, and file server takes in root file system. What is file system? File system's interface. It's got to have this. So some crazy tracing. We want to trace that all the way. But basically, you say, hey, HTTP dir assets. Assets, right? So I want that assets folder. I want things to be served from there. Okay, so from that assets folder, I want things to be served. So that's the line that does it. And gives me a file server, which is a handler. Now I could do handle, and when anything comes in at images, run that handler. So much easier to understand than strip and prefix. You have some commentary?
The main reason you don't strip the prefix is if you go to the template and look at the actual path it's using, it's the path it's using will match. If you go to the template.
Yeah, so I don't have to strip prefix because I'm just saying, hey, now just go to images. And so this comes in, this request comes in, it's at images. It runs here and says, okay, I'm going to run that handler, which is a file server, and I'm going to file serve this.
The file server is going to receive images slash the file name, and it's going to start in the assets folder. And the assets folder's got an images folder with the files in it. So there's no strip prefix required in this case.
And later we'll be doing Sudoku puzzles. Anyhow, I like that refactor. I like that line.
Did you say that there was a small error?
That's right here. The biting, the invalid bytes. So, and then I was ready to start uploading images. So I made this a debugging challenge. Because when I run 17, change directory, and I don't know if I need to do that. All right, so there's that, and I'm going to choose a file, and there we go. And submit. And what happened? Sweet. Maybe it's working. Choose another file. And that one. Oh, it's not working. I could only upload one photo, right? And then I look at this, and there's a whole bunch of stuff in here because I added in a whole bunch of debugging. I'm like, what is going on? So I added in all these debugging statements, debugging, where am I at my code, debugging, right, debugging. And so then here is the hint, which helps you solve the debugging challenge. So let's run that and just see it. Cookie value. Cool. And let's upload a picture. Cookie value. Well, this is different. That's my UUID.
It detected the picture that the cookie was tampered with because you were using your cookie from the previous one, which had an image already uploaded.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So I request my cookie. And if there's no cookie, I set a cookie. And then I print that out. So this is my first cookie that got printed right here. And all I have is in pictures. I actually have two.
So you uploaded pictures from the previous project.
Yeah, from the previous project. Let's run it again. Boom, 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 boom. Let me go clear that out. Nothing's there. Run it. So now I have that. And there's my first cookie. This. And I'm going to upload. But before I hit submit, where'd that first cookie came from? We ran this line. There's no cookie, so we did new cookie, and we set it. And then we printed out the cookie value. And this returned if false, so that returned false. It wasn't tampered with. And then, you know, request method wasn't post. And then we just got the model and executed the template. So that's the first time to the page, okay? Second time to the page, I'm going to upload a photo. And so now, when I uploaded a photo, my UUID is the same. And then we have state, false, pictures, one JPEG.
Wait.
This was one. And this one was, right, without the quotes. And so we got a different HMAC. No. Yes.
That's the cookie value's got the same HMAC.
Same
but,
HMAC.
But when we calculate it.
Oh, right. Right, so what got stored here, right? So that's what got stored. So this was the first time the cookie got written, had quotes. So I said the quotes would come back to bite me. That was weird.
I think you copy-pasted.
I think I did. And then the second when the cookie got stored and then we wrote it back out, that's what it looked like. Because where do we write that first cookie? First cookie's here in our code, right? We create the cookie and then we write it. So we wrote it straight from our, we printed it. We wrote it and then we printed it straight from our code. Does that make sense? Like this value right here, this first time, is not getting it off the browser. And then the second time through our code, we say request cookie. Yeah, there is one. Here you go. And then we print it and the value we print out doesn't have quotes. So when it got stored, the quotes got stripped away. So now when we run a comparison of the HMAC, this is where we got our HMAC, right? We got our HMAC from this. But now when we run it coming back, we're going to run it against this. And it doesn't have the quotes, so it's going to give us a different value. So now when I upload another photo, I have a tampered cookie, so it gives me a new cookie, and then it adds that picture to it. Does that make sense?
So it's got a new UUID.
And it's got a new UUID. So it's kind of hard to read. But I should probably add in, like...
And that copy-paste didn't help either.
Yeah, that copy-paste didn't help either. Give us a few lines in there.
Backslash not a...
Thank you. Just like that. I thought I had backslash, didn't I? Those are backslashes.
Oh, yeah, they are.
They
okay.
Look bad up there.
Yeah, especially from an angle.
So how many people did not understand that?
Well, let's see if I can understand this right.
All right, articulate back to us.
So when you first load the page, it is loading it from the web store, correct? It's loading it from the code.
Yep.
So it has its own UUID and its own HMAC that is dependent on the code.
Yep.
When you submit a photo So that way you now have two photos on there. You have to run into the error where some quotes that were on the HMAC from the primary loading are no longer there. They were stripped off for some reason. So when you go to check to see if it was tampered, you get an error because the HMACs are not the same, so it goes ahead and makes you a new cookie.
Yeah.
And it says that you are a new visitor now.
Yeah, perfect.
With a new UUID and a new HMAC.
Perfect.
So if you it would even activate that tampered code even if you just hit refresh without uploading a new thing, because it's the cookie. Not uploading an image specifically, but the cookie itself that's causing it.
So the first time I print line 32, where is cookie value coming from? Where is that cookie coming from? Tell me the line number. First time I go to this web page and line 32 prints, what line number is the cookie value that prints? Where is that cookie being created? 28. It's the first time there, you don't have a cookie. And so that isn't coming off of the browser. That's coming straight from our server, and that still has the quotes in it. Second time I print line 32, where's that cookie coming from? What line? 26. And that cookie comes from the browser, and the quotes have been stripped out. So we're going to get different HMACs, which means we have a tampered cookie, which means that we're just resetting the cookie to new visitor on line 35, which means the previous image uploaded is gone. We get the original first image everybody gets, and then whatever image you're uploading now. Kind of interesting, huh? And so now that's the first time, and that I have the quotes around, you know, the cookie, you know, one here. But then the second time I come through, which is upload a photo.
Or just
plain refreshing.
No quotes, right? Or refresh.
And what's also noticeable is that in the primary, the state and pictures also have quotes around them.
Yes. Yeah, the keys in the JSON object. Yeah, state and pictures.
Well, in the...
So. It's stripping all the quotes out, not just ones for the where the not just the pictures values.
New UUID that time, new user. Anyhow, that created a little fun puzzle for a while. So we could get around that with Base64 encoding. I've added 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, validate user photos. I've added photos for dealing with the photos here. But Base64 encoding, that's going to be under user, initial user, maybe, new visitor, and Marshall initial model. So let's look at all this code just from the get-go. Doon, 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 doon. Template, parse my templates, handle func, fav icon, file server, handle images, listen and serve, request the cookie. If it's not there, create a new one for a new user. There's the debugging hint. I'm in Base64, so I don't need that anymore because that was just for the previous code. If tampered, give them a new cookie. If request method is post, request form file, so this is coming from the form submission, and the name is data. So if we look at the index HTML, the name is data. That names the variable coming with the value from the form, right? Which is different than ID. It's type file. So if the name is data, then we do request form file, gives us back craziness, multi-part file header, and an error. And remember what we said about packets and multi-part files, right? So that's just what request form file gives us. If error is not nil, error uploading photo, and you do something where you create an error page to show the user, so that's a to-do. If you wanted to really make this, build this out, say, hey, there's an error uploading your photo, try again, or only these images are accepted, or whatever. And then we have, here I created a function upload photo. So upload photo takes in the multipart and a cookie. And so this is all that stuff we saw before with uploading a photo of the Gorilla website. So some interesting code, but basically it's getting a SHA of the file and making that the file name. And then getting the working directory and then saying where do we want to store that, right? And putting that as the path and then creating a file there and then copying the file that's uploaded to the new file we created with this specific name. And then returning, and we add photo, which is this one right here. So we pass in the file name and the cookie again. And so we get our model, and then we're going to append to our model. Remember, our model is a slice of string. So for this user, we need to append the name of the picture they've uploaded, right? So we append that. And so we get our model, and then we split the value from the cookie, and we get the ID, which is the UUID. And then we do a new, for this, we create a new cookie, and for that, we pass in the model and the ID to current visitor. And current visitor basically does the marshalling, and this is Marshall model, so this is a marshalled model, right? And then it makes a cookie. So this is just like a law of abstraction, because there's originally, we had a new visitor and initial state kind of deal. But now we have a new visitor and we have a current visitor. And that's why I changed this from new to user, right? And then they're both calling upon making a cookie. The new visitor will make a cookie, which will have a brand new UUID. A current visitor, we're just passing back in the ID they're using. And then we make that cookie and gives us back a cookie. And in the process, well, then afterwards, we marshal it to JSON. I don't know. It's just like all the refactoring in there. So basically, you can look through that on your own because it's actually quite a bit to... It's not that much, but it's been broken out so that there isn't repetitive code. Let's watch it run.
Feel free to clear your cookies.
Wah, wah, wah. You guys heard the story about Bill Gates driving a bulldozer?
You've already CD'd.
Thank you. And then nope. Pirates of Silicon Valley. Main got four. Oh, because I deleted that one. One line, yeah. That's always been kind of an interesting little thing. I don't know if it's true or not, but it was in Pirates of Silicon Valley. But Bill Gates had like played chicken with bulldozers with Steve Ballmer, I think, or he drove a bulldozer at a construction site at late at night. Nobody was around. Upload a photo. Upload a photo. Cool. And if we look at the cookie, I think we'll just see nonsense. I think it's already base64. Nonsense.
Try just looking at that cookie and figuring out what it means.
Hack somebody else. That's what that means. Go hack somebody else. No Paris Hilton photos for you. Or who is a recent celebrity who had their photos stolen? Whatever, right? Elvis. So then we just have a login and log out. So that'd be the next thing to build into it. Dang it. Please log in. Well, let's try one that's not secret. Sorry. Still works. And let's build in logout. Oh, it's still running. Jesus is in my web programming class. He's awesome. Created a world religion, super popular. Now he's learned code. So, still all works. True story. That's what he goes by. That's his name, Jesus. If I come back, I don't think it kept my state. I don't think I built that in. No, did not. So it's just while you're logged in. So we're going to continue to build on that, and eventually we'll get it to App Engine, and we'll have it running on App Engine, where then you can all log in from out there and upload photos, and we'll have a bunch of photos uploaded, but it's only going to show you your photos. And that's all stored cookie. Right now, that's how it's all stored. But that's pretty awesome. And I feel like, I mean, we did some... I don't know, what we call it, like repetition, going over these concepts, go over them and go over them. But that's really powerful, what you guys know, and that's totally secure and solid, and creating a web app with state that tracks user data, and we're storing all the information in a cookie, and from there it's just going to be an easy step to storing things in some sort of data storage. Now, what I do need to do before I finish up and push all this to GitHub, get rid of those things, because that's where my cookies are being stored right now. Anybody have questions? No questions? How many people do web programming in some other language? 1, 2, 3. And what are those languages? PHP. PHP? How do you like this compared to PHP? Which would you choose?
Right now I'm just getting the Go things.
You're just getting the Go thing? And you've been doing PHP how long?
2 years.
So you like PHP because you know it. You're like, oh man, this is different than what I know. And change is hard. And it's like hard if you already know how to ski. It's like, man, I know how to get down the hill and look good on my skis. And then you try snowboarding. You're like, I don't know if I like this snowboarding thing. Just keep falling on my butt. If you were to build a web app for you want to start something, what are you going to choose?
I don't know. Right now, PHP.
Right now, PHP. All right, that's cool. I like it. Maybe go. You'll come see us when you start to actually get a lot of users. You'll be like, how do I do it in Go?
Go will get more useful once the App Engine's data store. The Go data store library is really, really good.
Some other people raise their hands. What other languages?
Java.
Java's a pretty good contender. Java's pretty performant. And if you know it, but how long have you been doing Java web? So yeah, you're pretty familiar with it.
Well, I guess for education purposes, it's quite, you know,
somebody just tweeted me, or whatever this is called, texted me, if programming languages were weapons. C is the M1. Old but reliable. C++. Takes many years of pain to master, and often you probably wish you were using something else. Perl is a Molotov cocktail, useful once, but few people use it now. Java is a belt-fed 240G automatic weapon where sometimes the belt has rounds, sometimes it doesn't. When it doesn't during firing, you get an old pointer exception. The gun explodes and you die. Scala is a variant on Java, except the training manual is written in an incomprehensible dialect, which makes us suspect it's just gibberish. WTF. JavaScript is a sword without a hilt. that's funny. Go is a custom made, if air not equal nil, starter pistol, and after each shot you must check to make sure it actually shot. Also, it shoots tabs instead of blanks. That's funny. Rust is a 3D printed gun. It may work someday. Bash is a cursor hammer. When wielded, everything looks like a nail, especially your thumb. Python, double barrel shotgun. Only one barrel will shoot at a time. You never end up shooting the recommended one. Also, I probably should have used a line tool to draw that. Ruby is a ruby encrusted sword. It's usually only used because of how shiny it is. PHP is a hose. Usually plug one into a car exhaust and the other you stick in through the window and then you send the car and turn the engine on. That's funny. Mathematica is a low Earth orbit projectile canyon. Could probably do amazing things if anyone could actually afford one. A donkey with a... C Sharp is a powerful laser rifle strapped to a donkey. When taken off the donkey, laser doesn't seem to work as well. Prolong is an AI weapon. You tell it what to do, which it does, but then it also builds some terminators to go back in time and kill your mom. Lisp is a shiv, which comes in many forms. Anyone who uses this is probably crazy and dangerous. that's hysterical. I like that. Thank you. I don't quite understand the Go one.
the tabs instead of blanks.
What's tabs instead of blanks mean?
Oh, the Go thumb changes all your spaces into tabs.
Oh.
Yeah. Although I understand the first part very, very well.
Air not equals nil, and after every shot, you have to check to make sure it actually shot.
It is the only thing.
Yeah, people complain about that.
That sometimes I get tired of, even though it's completely necessary.
I just recorded
it's better,
a...
It's better than trying to remember the try, which thing, what you have to try to catch, with try catches all the time.
I just recorded a little bit on air handling for Go. I just haven't edited it, but I'll get that up soon. And you guys can watch it. Talks about if air not equal nil. Who sent that? Sweet. Thanks, Shen. Where'd you find it? That was cool.
We'd found it last during the web boot camp somewhere.
Oh, you did? That's totally sweet.
It might have been in the gift.